I'm in the Knapp Reserve at Malcolm Knapp Research Forest. Most areas of the research forest burned at some point, either in a fire in the late 1800s or one in the 1930s. But this particular area that I'm standing on the edge of escaped both of those fires. And so that means that there are trees in this stand that are over 400 years old. It's not a huge stand, but this is an old growth stand. There's no universal definition for what makes a forest old growth, but generally the definition refers to a forest with very old trees, and that's a little bit imprecise, where ecological processes such as stand dynamics and succession have been able to occur without the influence of human intervention for a significant length of time. In British Columbia, the legal definition of old growth is a coastal forest with trees that are at least 250 years old, or an interior forest with trees that are at least 140 years old. And while that's a definition that's very clean cut and very easy to determine, it's not especially meaningful because just age alone doesn't necessarily capture what is going on in an old growth forest. Aside from just age, it can be useful to think about what other characteristics old growth forests possess when we're deciding if something is old growth or not. The first is having really big trees, typically widely spaced. I've got a monster Douglas fir next to me right here. There's a number of large trees in this area. Some of them are probably 1.5 up to 2 meters in diameter. This isn't the biggest old growth around, but these are big trees. But size is relative. In the coastal western hemlock zone where we are, these are very productive forests. Trees can grow quite large. But if we were in a subalpine forest, for example, we might have trees that are a similar age, but might be only 50 centimeters DPH or 30 centimeters DPH, but they still might be quite old. So it's a little bit, the size is a little bit relative with regard to what size of trees that ecosystem can produce. The canopies of old growth forest are dominated by long-lived shade-tolerant species. Douglas fir here is an exception to that, though. Coastal Douglas fir is a shade-intolerant species, meaning it needs lots of light to regenerate. However, it's a bit unusual among shade-intolerant species in that it's really long-lived. Douglas fir, under good conditions, can live for 500 or 1,000 years. So even though Douglas fir can't regenerate in these forest conditions, it can remain present in the stand well into the old growth phase. So I mentioned old trees, and this is a little bit counterintuitive, but old growth forests will also have young trees in them. They will have a diverse range of tree ages. And that's because there's going to be the old trees, obviously, that's a core aspect of it. But the dynamics in old growth forests are such that there's constant tree regeneration happening. If we were to core a bunch of trees here, we would find a wide range of ages. Some trees would be very young, some would be over 400 years old. Along with that, we have a wide range of tree sizes. So we've got monster trees like this, but behind me there's quite a few hemlock saplings that are probably 2 or 3 centimeters DPH. I list both the diversity of sizes and ages. It's not the same thing. Those things are related. On average, the really big trees here are really old and the really small trees are young, but the correlation isn't perfect, especially when you have really shade-tolerant species like hemlock or western red cedar. You can have saplings in the understory that are relatively small, but are quite old. They're not growing much each year. They're getting just enough light for them to be able to sustain themselves and survive, but they won't put on a lot of growth unless a canopy gap opens up, giving them enough light to move on. So just because some of these trees here are much smaller doesn't necessarily mean that they're significantly younger. Old growth forests have incredibly complex structure, and that comes in a couple of different components. The first is vertical diversity. So if we look at the different layers of the canopy, this isn't a forest where we've got all the mature trees are one height and then there's no other trees growing below, or maybe we just have a small layer of shade-tolerant trees below. These forests over time develop really complex multi-layered canopies where you have some trees that may be much taller than other canopy trees, you've got canopy trees, and then you have understory trees occupying many different levels in the forest. Along with that vertical diversity, we have horizontal diversity. And I think the best way to think of this, maybe there are two ways. If you imagine a bird's eye view of the forest, it isn't going to look uniform across the area. It's going to look patchy. There's going to be areas with taller trees, areas with shorter trees, areas that are more open, areas that are more dense. There's going to be diversity in a horizontal direction. Or conversely, if you imagine moving through that forest, as you move through the forest, it's not going to look the same in every location. The structure is going to vary quite a bit from one location to another. And then there are important non-living aspects to the structure. One is snags, And surprisingly, this tree that I'm standing next to is actually a snag. I'm glad it is not a windy day because I don't typically like standing next to snags in the forest. But this is a massive tree. I don't know how long it has been dead, but I think it's going to be here for a very long time. So snags are standing dead trees, and they provide important structure, important habitat for organisms. And then when those snags fall down, they become what's called coarse woody debris. So this is logs, broken off stumps, big limbs, basically dead wood that is lying on the forest floor. And because a old growth forest has been allowed to develop for a long time, and that wood, especially in a climate zone like this, decays relatively slowly, you tend to have lots of coarse woody debris accumulating on the forest floor. The stand dynamics within an old growth forest are dominated by small scale disturbances. This makes sense if you think about it, because a large severe disturbance would have high enough mortality that it would set the successional stage of that stand back, and you would no longer have those old trees, which are a critical component of old growth. But when you have very small patchy disturbances, like wind, for example, where an individual tree or small group of trees may be blown down, but others will be unscathed, or small pockets of disease or pest outbreaks, or just senescence, just the natural death by old age of trees. Some of those trees are going to survive all of those disturbances and become very old. But then those small patches of death lead to what we call gap dynamics. So there may be a tree in the overstory that dies, and now we have a lot of light getting through to the understory. And so those shade tolerant species that were growing in the understory now have a lot of light available, so some of them are going to be able to increase their growth greatly and maybe recruit into the canopy, grow big enough that they become canopy trees. And that extra light will probably also help other shade-tolerant species in that area regenerate. So that's part of what creates this complex vertical structure where we have these different layers. And you can imagine an area where there's been a death of a tree or a small group of trees, the light conditions are going to be very different there than they would be in a nearby area that has a very dense canopy. So these gap dynamics are also what helps generate that horizontal diversity in the forest. So once a forest reaches old growth stage, typically the cereal species or early successional species have already died or kind of are at the end of their lifespan. As I said, Douglas fir is a little bit of an exception. So as those trees drop out, those gaps start getting filled by the shade tolerant species. So over time, we have a forest dominated by those shade tolerant, long-lived species. Some of the trees will be quite old, some of the trees will be much younger since they've regenerated in those gaps. And those processes continue over a long period of time, and that mortality also contributes to snags and coarse woody debris. So you can see how the structures that we observe in an old growth forest relate to the processes that are driving the dynamics that are happening in that forest.